Matthew 13, the same passage that we read responsively earlier. Matthew 13, verses 2 to 9 and 18 to 23. Matthew chapter 13, verses 2 to 9 and 18 to 23. As we come to the Word of God, we shall meditate on this passage taken from Matthew 13. As I gave you an introduction to this chapter last Lord's Day, I said here we have a series of the kingdom parables spoken by our Lord Jesus Christ. The master teacher, our Lord himself, taught wonderful and great truths of his kingdom by means of parables. Now, parables were stories taken from the familiar settings of daily life in order to teach the spiritual realities of his heavenly kingdom. Earthly stories describing heavenly truths. The story in itself do not have the truth, but it has to be explained. And the story is said to help us to have a clearer perception of the spiritual truths. Matthew in chapter 13 relates to us seven parables, beginning with the parable of what is generally known as the sower. Well, I will come to the title of this first parable later, but at this time, take note. The first parable is the parable of the sower, as it is mentioned by our Lord himself. And then he tells us a series of six parables in this chapter. And they are divided into two groups of three. The six are divided into two groups of three, separated by an explanation of the parable of the weeds. So you will have three, three. Now each of the last six is introduced by the kingdom of heaven is like phrase. So you have that phrase, kingdom of heaven, kingdom of heaven. So this is a kingdom parable series. Now, some people have suggested that these seven parables in chapter 13 were spoken at different times in Jesus' life and ministry, and Matthew has put them together. But I just want to say, I don't think that's the case. I think all these seven were spoken in one occasion. And we can assume that's the case because of Matthew's statement in verse 53. Just take a quick look at that. Verse 53. It says, and it came to pass that when Jesus had finished these parables, he departed thence. He finished these parables. So that tells us that Matthew says Jesus were saying all these parables one after another, and then he came to an end. It's not that he said these parables on different occasions and then Matthew collected them and put there. That's not the idea that Matthew gives. Matthew actually tells us he said them all in one go, completed it, and went on to the next things that he wanted to do. And so it is quite interesting that he said so many parables in one go, seven parables. Now, the first parable which is our study today, was taken from the agricultural scene of the land. And it was about sowing. A very familiar activity to the people of Jesus' time, especially the crowd that was around the Galilee region. They come from an agricultural or agrarian society. Farming, sowing, reaping, all these were common sights. Now, just a word about the title of this psalm. Should we call it this or that? There are a lot of ideas that we have. Now, when I first suggested this topic, the parable of the soils, I was focusing on the emphasis that Jesus is giving in the story itself. He talks about not different kinds of seeds. The seed is the same, it's a gospel seed. He's not talking about different kinds of sowers. He's just talking about one sower. But the thing that is emphasized is the differing grounds, the soil, where the seed is falling, and the resultant things that comes out of that particular sowing in different grounds. So I thought it would be good to capture that emphasis Jesus makes about the different kind of ground, and so I called it the parable of the soils. But when I studied more, by then, of course, the title was given, which was on Friday, which I gave, and then started to think about it on Saturday morning and this morning more. And I thought, maybe I shouldn't call it the parable of the soils. Maybe I should call it what Jesus himself called it. So maybe it's good for us to think about this parable from the title that Jesus says. And I think I will do that, God willing, next Lord's Day, if the Lord permits. We will take another look at this parable from that point. And you may want to just take note of this, that Jesus says in verse 18, when he interpreted the parable. You know, the interpretation of this parable is found in verses 18 to 23. And in verse 18, Jesus himself says, "Hear ye therefore what? The parable of the sower." He doesn't say the parable of the soils, but he says the parable of the sower. And so there is a need for us to really think that. And I will do that, God willing, next Lord's Day. So I'm going into the details, and so I stick to this theme, parable of the soils, and we're going to look at the different kinds of ground into which the sower cast his seed. Now, as I said, the farmer's methods and experiences may be odd to us, because we live in a city, but they were typical of that day. Everybody knew. So Jesus was not telling this story to tell them what he's sowing all about. He was not telling them an unfamiliar story. What he was doing was taking them from a familiar situation to an unfamiliar reality of the spiritual experiences, principles, and truths. And that's what we must pay attention to. So there you have Christ starting with that which is simple and moving the entire crowd to what is more profound in life. You know, all of us are stuck in many things that are mundane to our life, whether it be cooking or going to work or studying, ironing the shirt or looking better, and all these things we do, and we are very familiar with these things. But beyond that, beyond all these things, the spiritual realities of His kingdom must be held with great fondness in our mind. In fact, you can even say the mundane things of life are only a step to understand greater things of God. You should never replace the greatness of God and the realities of the spiritual kingdom into which we are called by the gospel of Christ. We cannot get lost in the things of this world. But right now, when you're doing whatever you're doing, you should be able to see beyond what you're doing the spiritual realities. If you are a father to your children, don't stop just being a father by providing for their daily need and worrying about the future. But remember, you have a great Father in heaven. You must do what you are doing as a father in the great reality of the fatherhood of God. To the point you must make your children realize it is more important to trust God, the Heavenly Father, than you yourself. If you're working, if you are washing plates in your kitchen, or you are ironing the clothes, you know, these things we do because they are not the ultimate things in life. Whenever we do these things, we see beyond these things the greatness of God, a God who works daily. I work because God works. God is not a lazy God sitting at one corner and forget His people. He takes care of all His creatures. He cares for them. He provides for them. He guides them. He supervises them. He puts His enemies at their corner. He keeps the entire universe to function as it is. Even that which you don't know, when you comb your hair, you just keep them that way, but you don't know whether you're losing hair or not until more are gone. But even one will not drop onto the ground without His knowledge. And you've got to understand the reason why you work is not because you are going to be somebody great, but you want to resemble the greatness of your God whom you follow. Your attitude at work must reflect your Savior, your God. As you clean your clothes or wash your plates, you must know there's a God who cleanses us. And you've got to pray for His cleansing of our hearts. When you put things all in order and keep them nice and neat, why do you do it? You cannot be obsessed with that. You must know there is a God who commands us, who does all things in good order. There's an orderliness to everything God does. God didn't create a chaotic world. He created a beautifully functioning, orderly world. And in that world, we dress and keep the things that God made as His servants, not as gods. We are not God. He is God. And we do this in obedience to His principles, reflecting His greatness and seeking His goodness in the midst of our mundane life. One of the things you're going to see through the parables is that the Lord wants you to see beyond what the mundane experience of life. And you must learn to rejoice in the greatness, in the goodness, righteousness, truth, and faithfulness of our great God in the midst of your life's endeavors. If you can't do that, you're missing out really what is most important. And you are really like a person who tried to get good things out of a rubbish heap. You're working very hard, but dirtying yourself more and more, eating things that are really going to make you sick. But you are in there. I tell you, this whole world is a dirt pile if you do not see the glory of God and work for His greatness. Here the Lord lifts the familiarity of the people to a realm that they must go to. And that is the principles of God's kingdom. The story is altogether a very simple story. It's not complicated. It's familiar, easy to understand. Let's take a look. Verse 3. And he spake many things unto them in parables. So please get ready to learn many things. Many profound things God teaches. The Lord Jesus teaches through these parables. And I pray that you will learn them. And this will not be a complete sermon on this, this parable, I'm sorry. You must revisit it. And I hope whatever I say today will trigger your hunger for the truths that are revealed in these parables. Jesus says, behold, a sower. So there was only one sower, not many sowers in this story, just one man. One sower went forth to sow. A very determined man. You can know whether a person is a sower or fisherman when you look at him. A sower will have a unique kind of appearance. He will be carrying a bag full of seed or a basket full of seed, and he will have the tools that will help him to plow the land and make the furrows in the land so he can sow the seed. There are unique things that are about him. He's a sower, ready to sow. And then Jesus continues in verse 4. When he sowed, so he's not one who leaves halfway through. He really carries on with his work. Some seeds, or some fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. And that's an interesting situation. Why would a man sow the seed and let the seed fall on the wayside? Now, you need to understand a little bit of the situation or the background of the people and their habits in agriculture. Even today, if you go to Galilee area, you would see long stretches, wide lands of farming. But today, it's no more grains. They have all sorts of plantations. You know, they have orchid plants being planted, large areas. They have bananas. They have oranges. They have avocados. It's really amazing. They're beautiful to see if you are in Israel in that area. Very fertile land. And in those days, they used to sow. Remember, in those days, they didn't have the kind of roads that we have today. They didn't have the kind of footpaths that we have. People just walk across the land. They normally walk, or they'll be on the top of a donkey or a horse or a camel or something like that. And so they don't have fixed roads all the time. People walk, and when they walk, they make sure they try not to destroy any farming that is being carried out. So as long as they can find a path through it, they will just walk through it. And if people continue to walk along that narrow stretch where no farming is done, it becomes a hard, beaten ground. And that is called a path. It's not because it is a recognized footpath with a street name on it. You know, it is not like Lorong 28 or Koshy Lane or anything like that. It's just passed through, and that becomes a beaten path, a hard ground. So a big piece of land And the man is trying to sow the seed. And when he sows the seed, he also knows there are areas where people walked and the land has become hardened. And that's called wayside. Normally it is at the borders of a person's ground. You can see that. A large piece of land and there are borders along. And you can see the borders are actually not so much compound walls and fences, but footpaths, paths that people walk by. And so when a man casts a seed, as you know, he's very careful when he casts a seed. He takes a good measure of seed in his hand, and he know how far how much of the land must be scattered with this seed, and he will carefully, he has a way of doing it, cast the seed. And when he does that, some of it will surely fall on those beaten paths, the wayside. Not that he purposely go there and lay the seed. He aims for the good ground, but as he casts the seed, some will fall there. But because the beaten path is hard, the seed will not sink into the soil. It will stay on the top. But in the good ground, which is plowed and furrows are made, the soil is soft and it will quickly go deep. You know, one of the interesting things that you would see, when a man starts sowing, the birds of the sky will know the man is sowing and they come for the seed. Easy pick, right? They don't have to go and look for the seed. It's all on the ground for them to eat. So one of the worst enemies of a farmer is a bird. He dislikes the birds, actually, especially during the time of sowing. They are a big trouble. And the birds are waiting for the man to turn his back so the bird can pick it up. And that's the scene we have here. When he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them, especially the seeds that were still on the top of the ground, on the beaten paths, and they were taken. Now, this is cited by Christ for a very specific purpose. And this we know when we study what explanation he has given in verse 19. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart, and this is he which received seed by the wayside. You see, Jesus is trying to talk about the various experiences in the kingdom of God on earth. We must understand, and let it be very well understood today by all of you. When the word of God is preached, it is like the casting of the seed, sowing of the seed. It is thrown across. No preacher, starting with the Lord Jesus Christ and all his servants, ever preach that it may fall on the wayside. It's not my desire. My only prayer today is that all of you are good soil. However, the reality of the kingdom of God on earth is that God permits all sorts of people to come in. But some are hardened hearts, beaten paths. And, you know, nobody would ever know whether you are the beaten path, the hard ground or not, than you yourself. You can know it better than any other man. You will know about your own condition better than the preacher. How do you know? Pay attention to what Jesus said. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one, and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. So a man who listens to the preaching, and he really doesn't understand why it is being said. Not that he has no intelligence, but he doesn't perceive it. He doesn't spiritually perceive. Many years ago when I was preaching in the seminar room that we have just across, I think it's no more a seminar room, they changed that into something else. We were a small congregation and we had a gospel rally there. I think the gospel rally had very poor attendance. Only about 3 or 4 people came that day, though we invited scores of people. And one was a gentleman whom I never known, and after preaching the gospel, I came down and talked to those guys who were there for the first time, and this man whom I approached, and I said, thank you for coming, and I wish, I hope and pray that you understand my message. And he said, oh, I understand the message. Very happily, he said, oh, sure, I got it. I know what you're saying. I said, oh, that's good. I'm glad you understand. And may I ask what do you say? What's your response? Actually, when I said that, I saw his face changing. I don't know whether he heard me saying, what's your response? But he said this to me. Why do you ask me the question whether I understand or not? You think I don't know English? Of course I understand. I understood everything you said. I said, oh, no, I don't mean to say whether you understand English or not. What I meant is, what's your response to what I preached, since you understood it? You say, well, I don't really understand what you preach. You see, on one hand, he understands. On the other hand, he doesn't understand. I never forget that conversation. You understand, yet you don't understand why you should listen to it or why you should come back and think about it. I tell you, that gospel preaching did not even gone 1 millimeter down into his heart. The devil took it away. He was not interested. Then I said, would you like to come back? Do you have any questions? I asked a few things to encourage him to dwell on the gospel that he heard, and we can then help him to grow. His answer was, no, I'm not interested. Thank you very much. That's it. You see, when a sower sows the seed, it is for the ground to absorb it, and so the seed will grow down and die inside, and the shell will go off, and the life springs forth. And there's this process that should happen within that heart, where the seed of God's word goes in and it does its work. I can't talk about the exact process that happens in every heart, but it's a divine work by the power of the gospel. The man feels it, and it brings about the life. And it doesn't happen in some heart. So ask yourself, is your hearing of God's word making sense to you? Does it appear to you that these are the most important things in life? You can't let these things ever be outside your heart. It has to be brought into your heart, and it must really affect your heart, and you must enjoy whatever the word has meant to produce in your life. You want to have it. That is very important. So ask yourself, am I a wayside Kira? Now let's look at the second soil or the ground into which the seed is cast. Verse 5. Some fell upon the stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up because they had no deepness of earth. Now some fell upon stony places. Well, again, if you go to Israel and look around, it's a very stony land. Plenty of stones. You know, when there is a clash between the Palestinians and the Jews, what do the Palestinians use as their weapon? Stones. They always throw stones. There's plenty of stones. It's like endless. Everywhere stone. So if a farmer has to really farm the ground, he had to pick up all the stones and move them around. It's a stony land. Some people say it's because of ancient volcano eruptions that the stones are scattered. It's like people throw the stones all over the place. Huge boulders, small ones, rocks, and everywhere. So sometimes when you look at a fertile land, you're sure to see rocks in the middle of it. You wonder where they come from. How come there are rocks like this? It's like somebody thrown them into the midst of the plain fields. And so not all stones are easy to be removed. And you can also see, if you go to Israel, that sometimes the farmers, at least in the modern times, I don't know about ancient times, modern times, you can see the many of these farmers put these stones in a line, forming certain kind of division within the land that they have. It can be the border or like a fence, or some for other reasons they sort of divide the land. And you can see this long stretch of loose stones nicely laid to mark those boundaries. It's a ground filled with stones. And sometimes there are certain areas that are so full of stones that they can't use that as a farmland. So again, when the sower cast the seed, some seed fell among the stones. But you see, one of the things about the rock is that you won't probably see the rock in its entirety. You maybe see the tip of it. The rest is buried in the ground. And so the soil there is not very deep. Immediately after the first layer of soil, you have rock. So the roots cannot go deep down. The life will come forth. The leaf will suddenly shoot forth, but they won't last long because of the lack of deepness of soil. And what did Jesus say about it? Please take a look at verses 20 and 21. But he that received the seed into stony places, the same is he that heareth the word, and anon with joy receiveth it. Yet hath he not root in himself, but dureth for a while. For when tribulation or persecution ariseth because of the word, by and by he is offended. He is unhappy. You see, there are people in the church who are very happy to hear God's word being preached. There are people who come and say to me, "That was a good message. That was a good message. Oh, you spoke very well." Recently, a gentleman who was here sent me an email comment on my message, his opinion. And he's a learned man. At least that's what he tried to impress me with. He tried to tell me what are the qualifications he has and so on. And he said, "Oh, you are a very good speaker. You spoke professionally." And then he says, "I will like to come back and listen to you, but I would like to suggest that it is wonderful. It will be much better if you keep your sermon between 40 to 45 minutes. And so I wrote back to him, and, you know, I, not that I want to whack him, but I wrote back to him that I said, well, I was glad that you came to hear God's word being preached. I would like to let you know that I've been a pastor in this church for 25 years now, and I started preaching less than 30 minutes. 20 minutes was too long for me. My knees used to, you know, beat against one another, and I just explained my experience, and then I said, with time, the Lord has taught me His word, and I rejoice in His truth, and I want the people in the church to understand not only the meaning, but also the application of it in their life. And so I spent time trying to explain these things, and the people rejoiced. Yes, there were some who were unhappy, some left, but the Lord has increased the church, and the Lord showed it to me that people enjoyed the truth. And so I continue to preach, and I have even preached 1.5 hours on certain Sundays. And then he replied and told me that he himself is a lecturer, and there were times he taught throughout the day, and if it's necessary, I should do that. And then he also said he is a Toastmaster, you know, he got certain certificate from that club and this and that, and tried to impress me with his resume. I'm not laughing at him. I think he's trying to tell me that he's really an experienced man. And he said, well, if it is good for your congregation, please continue to do so. Thank you very much. And so that's a response I just received a few weeks ago. Why do you come to church? To hear an eloquent preacher, a professional preacher? There are people who came to this church for more than 10 years and had never saved. Always told me, I don't believe in Jesus Christ, but would come. When I confronted them and said, this is bad. The person is willing to give offering, even though we do not want unbelievers to be ever persuaded to give offering. I can't stop if somebody put offering into the offering bag. We don't ask them to do. But he used to do it. I know it. Not one. At least right now in my mind, I have 3 people who have been in the church, in this church for more than 5 years, but never got saved. They never confessed Christ. They refused to be believers and baptized. And they finally left. But in those days, they used to tell me it was a good message. I know of a man who came up and said, this is the kind of preaching that pastors must learn to preach. I really appreciate you. So I said, why don't you believe now? I'm thinking about it. This is how some people are. You can see a kind of excitement that will almost make you think they are true believers. They will agree. Even when they disagree, they will not air it. They are very willing to consider it again, give some thought to it. They stay there. But they will not have any interest in letting the word take their whole life, entire being fully. There is a level to which they will allow the word of God to enter, not beyond it. You know, that joy which Jesus talks about in verse 20 is temporal. It's not lasting joy. Temporal joy of listening to God's word is not good enough. You come here and you like the preaching of the pastor, you can feel very good. Today we attended a good service. The pastor is good, he preached well. And that's all. You forget from Sunday evening what you heard. You don't let the word of God that you heard ever take control and make the change necessary in your heart. You might come back. You may come back even with your friends. And my dear friends, I don't want to rejoice in it. Because it is not a process that leads you into the kingdom of God. You do not respect the king wholeheartedly. I am not here to entertain a people who has no desire to give wholehearted commitment to the king. I'm not an entertainer. I'm not a performer. I am a servant of the Most High King. And every preacher should know that. And you, my dear brethren, you need to get this in your mind. That partial joy is not what God wants from us. But a wholehearted joy of listening, having it clearly buried deep in our hearts. From there, the life of God may germinate, flourish, and bear fruit. Look at the third ground. Verse 7. And some fell among the thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. Some among thorns. Thorns are also a plenty in the Palestinian land. Well, they made a crown of thorns for Jesus. All kinds of thorns. And they are really a big problem in the farming community. They grow up all of a sudden. Even you pluck them away and you cast the seed and suddenly they grow up. They grow faster than the good seed. That's the way they are. Real problem. Now, what is the interpretation Jesus gave? Please take a look at verse 22. He also that receives seed among the thorns is he that heareth the word, and the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches, and choke the word, which he becometh unfruitful. So those who receive the word, which are like the seed that fell on among the thorns, is he that heareth the word, and the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches and all other affairs of this life chokes the word. Listen, when you come to hear God's word, it is to drive away the care of this world. It is not to feed you with more care, more worry about tomorrow. People who live for this world, materialistic people, people who are constantly worrying for tomorrow, will never grow. Soon they feel the pressure. They will say, you don't understand. It's very hard to be like what you say in the scriptures in Singapore. It's very hard. I've got to work. I've got to work and work and work. Hey, brother, do you have time for reading the scriptures? Do you have time to pray? Do you have time to self-examine yourself? Do you have the time and opportunity to serve the Lord? Why not you come for prayer meeting? Why not you do this? No, Pastor, you don't understand. It's very hard. If it's so hard with your work, why don't you quit and go for another job so you can flourish in the things of God? Pastor, you don't understand. It's very difficult. I already made many commitments, you know. I got a new car. I got a big house. And if I quit now, and I'm already 40 years old, very hard to get another job that will pay me all this. I mean, pay this much money. Wow. Right. You're right. Yes. I understand. You are choked. You feel suffocation. You cannot. You don't have to read the scriptures, huh? Because you don't have time. Yes. Yeah, you don't have to really pray to the Lord. You don't have to serve God as you like. That's enough. You don't have to ask God, should I serve thee, O Lord? What is my part? I am part of the church. I am a member of thy body. And I am supposed to be active. And what is my role? No, don't ask. Because if you ask, you've got to serve. You've got to quit your work. So don't. Stay there. You know, I have in BP churches some funny situations that I hate to tell you today. There are guys who want to be elders, big-time people in the church. They are highly educated. They hold high offices. They are great people. And they get this title, elders. When the session meeting comes, they are not there because they are on overseas trip. The next session meeting comes, they are not there, overseas trip. But they must be elected. What is an elder if he is not there to take care of the church? It's not an honorary position in the church. Who is a deacon? Now let me tell you, if you become a deacon, if you are called by God to be a deacon or an elder or a pastor or whatever, and that's your position, that is God's appointment in your life, in his kingdom. And nobody should ever come into these positions of service without being absolutely sure of God's call. And once they are there, they better know that is to be honored at the expense of all other things. Don't tell me all these stories. You think I have no burden? You think I don't have aspirations like you to make money and live in a big house and be, what is that? If I as a pastor is expected to suffer all things and do not allow the world to choke me, do not allow the desire to be prosperous or desire to have better things ever choke me, but remain in obedience to his word and his calling, what makes you different as a Christian? Tell me. Now, who in the world taught you this? But the devil and his servants who fill the church pulpits today. Or some misguided Christians. We like the title Christian. We like the titles of elders and deacons and all other honorable positions. But you know, all these things are never given to people who do not prove their love for the King. It's all about kingdom principles. It's all about King and his manifesto. But 1,000 reasons are often cited. That tells us nothing but you are choked. I tell you something. When the word of God starts to grow, it really grows. The stem comes forth. The branches grow out. And the leaves grow abundantly. Then the flowers and the fruit. And it becomes a beautiful sight. Or if it is not a tree, then it is, if it is something like a corn or rice or whatever, then they will also grow according to what God designed. And they take space and time and they fulfill their appointment in their existence on earth. And so is a Christian. In him is the word. In him, the word must flourish. Now watch this very carefully. The scripture here says, or Jesus said, according to the scripture here, that the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke, you know what? Choke what? The word. Choke the word. In other words, the word of God, the words of Christ cannot flourish in you. That is being suppressed. Now check your life. Is the word of God coming to full fruition in your life? Or is the world growing? That's very important. Everywhere, when we send our people, whether our children or our church members, to study and work, I often tell them this. The first thing, you must make sure that you have an opportunity to grow in the Lord, and His word can take care of you. I don't care whether you got admission to Princeton or Oxford or Cambridge or some big school. I rather send my children to neighborhood school or whatever facility we have so that they can come to church and hear the word than send them overseas. I rather let we be in areas where we can work or do business, even though it is very small and very limited in scope, and focus on the fact that we must grow in the word of God. If not, there is a choking of the word, and it is dangerous. Look at that. All these three descriptions are detrimental to spiritual life. It ends up in zero. Absolute deadness. The wayside, the rocky ground, and the thorny ground. All comes to nothing. And this is what we should never be in. But look at the last one quickly. Verse 8. But other fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. And Jesus said, who hath ears to hear, let him hear. And look at this ground. It's called good ground. Good ground. Verse 23 is the interpretation of it. But he that received seed into the good ground is he that, now watch three things that the Lord says that makes the heart a good ground. He heareth the word, understandeth it, and bear fruit and bring forth it. Bear fruit and bring forth it. So three things. Hear the word, understand the word, and bear the fruit. Just want to explain that very quickly. It's not just hearing, but understanding it. You remember the Lord said a while ago, they hear but do not understand. They hear, but they allow the cares of this world to choke the word. And now he says, they hear it, they understand it, and bear fruit. A good ground will not have anything that will impede the growth of the seed. It will not allow anything to remain in its heart that will obstruct the growth of the word of God. May God help this church, all of us, you and me, never to be just excited hearers of God's word. Then we are all just spectators. We come to the church like people go to a stadium or to arena to watch a performance or a sports event. We all enjoy it, but we never get playing that game, right? But it is said sometimes that Singapore soccer has 12 players. Normally, soccer team has 11, right? Have you heard of this? Now, if you listen to FAS claims, they will say, oh, Singapore got 12 players. and the 12th player is the crowd. You know, and so they say, what, referee Caillou or something like that. And they ask all kinds of things, and they intimidate the referee and intimidate the opposition team as much as they can. So last time when they have the Malaysian Football Cup where Singapore was part of, they come to Singapore, the Malaysian states would say, we are going to Lion's Den. And they were scared to come. You know, they were scared of Lion. The Singapore team was known as the Lions. And so they said, it's very hard to go and play in Singapore. So, all the problems occurred because of that and so on. Now, you can't be in the church like spectators. You may make a little bit of noise. You may cheer the pastor. You may give him a cup of coffee. Or you may pat on his shoulder and say, good, oh, let's go for Makan, Pastor Koshy, and you invite me and you tell me how much you appreciate. But I'm not satisfied. That's not what the Lord wants in you. What the Lord wants you in you is that His Word take deep root and start growing. And you must make sure. You must make sure your hearing doesn't end here. It must start now and must continue until you die. Make sure these truths are growing. There are some people in our church which I'm very mindful of who not only hear, they go back and they take the notes and they read, and some of them listen to the message again. I'm not asking all of you to do the same. But the point is that if the Lord has spoken to you, you must pay attention to it and make sure the truth is not hindered in your heart. What kind of ground are you? The sower is one and the seed is one. But the ground matters. May we pray, Lord, may my ground be the kind of ground you want to be. If Christ is a preacher and he wants you to be the good ground today, my question is it a good ground? If your ground is good, then it will be the kind of ground that the preacher Christ himself wants. And he wants one ground. He looks for that ground which is ready to hear, understand, and bear fruit. Do not go away today with any other kind of attitude in your heart. That you pray, Lord, what I heard is that I must honor my King and His Word in my heart every day, and teach me to bear fruit. A fruit-bearing Christian. Not one who chokes the word, but one who let the word grow to all the good pleasures of God being fulfilled in us. Let us arise and sing our final hymn.